I've ever done started innocently enough in the form of a note passed to me. It was Friday afternoon in sixth grade, and I was sitting next to two of my closest friends when the note came my way. As I opened it, so carefully folded into a square with a pull tab, I wondered who it was from, hoping maybe a boy. But when I opened it and read it, the first thought that popped into my head was, uh-oh. Entering McDonald Middle School in East Lansing, Michigan, 6th through 8th grade, had terrified me almost as much as it excited me. I was leaving the safety of contained classrooms and recess three times a day to a vast building of changing classes, school dances, dressing for gym, girls who shaved their legs, got their periods, and everything else I had read about in Are You There, God, It's Me, Margaret. It was both daunting and thrilling. I worried about getting lost, figuring out how to open my locker, grades that now counted, and if I'd have any of my friends in my classes. But above all else, my most pressing concern, would I be popular? My eighth grade neighbor, Margie Pasloff, the closest thing I had to an older sibling, gave me the lowdown on being accepted at McDonald's. Do not buy the school lunch. Always bring your own. Never wear clothes from Sears or Kmart. The coolest place to shop is Jacobson's. From what I gleaned from Margie, a member of the popular crowd herself, this entry into middle school was the one and only time to make a good impression. Taking her advice as gospel, I declared to my mom I wanted to go school shopping at Jacobson's. I got the green Esprit vest with giant pink lettering. Because clearly the best way to assure people you wore the right clothes was to advertise the brand as largely as possible. So sixth grade began, and despite my debut Esprit outfit and carefully packed brown bag lunches, it quickly became clear I would not be in the popular group. Unbeknownst to me, it seemed that most of the group had been arranged before school even started, either through the legacy of one's older sibling or simply by God's hand. As far as I could tell, people were born popular, and that was not a part of my heritage. It wasn't just the friendships they already seemed to have, it was how they carried themselves, with ease and confidence, wearing brands of clothing I hadn't even heard of. So while I resigned myself to not becoming of the part of the popular group, I still wanted to fit in. If not embraced by them, at least accepted, tolerated, never ridiculed. My quest to get it right and become a sophisticated preteen no doubt took some comical missteps. My parents took one look at that black eyeliner I plastered on and said, no makeup. There was also an ill-advised perm, it was the 80s, and a quest to convince my father I had to have the light blue Reeboks instead of some less expensive off-brand. Despite these struggles, I was lucky to make good friends. Emily and Christy also shared my social status. The nice, smart girls, on the fringe of the popular crowd, savvy enough to know what was in, but with parents who frequently vetoed our choices to look cool or grow up. And then came that day in late winter when the note dropped in front of me. As I opened it up, a hard yellow candy fell out on the table. And the note read, "Hi, Erica. I thought you should know you seem like a really nice girl. Here's a little treat for you. I see you having fun and think that you must be a nice friend. I don't have any friends in this school. Would you be my friend? Pamela." Pamela Groot. As far as I could tell, Pamela's greatest sins were being from the poorest neighborhood in town and getting breasts before the rest of us. As any sixth grader will tell you, a girl who develops ahead of her peers is immediately deemed a slut. Perhaps because of this, she seemed to have a perpetual scowl on her face. And to be honest, I was a little afraid of her. She seemed like the type who might beat you up. She was right. She didn't have any friends. I held the lemon candy in my hand and looked over at Pamela, who gave me a shy smile. I surveyed her outfit, a very short denim skirt and a tight blouse. She had clearly missed Margie's advice of where to shop. Lots of blue eyeshadow and bright pink lipstick. Definitely slut material. I read the note again. Pamela was right. I was a nice person. I had nice friends. but my need to be nice was outweighed by my need to be accepted. And though I'd never be popular, I also knew that becoming friends with Pamela was social suicide. She never stood a chance. I showed the note to my friends. Then the three of us, the nice girls, crafted a joint rejection letter to Pamela. Pamela, no, I will not be your friend. We will never be your friend. Don't ever ask me again. I passed the note back to her. And then I ate the candy. Christy and Emily giggled. While I acted nonchalant, as if doing something this cruel was an everyday occurrence for me, inside I felt more conflicted. I spent the rest of the class with my face burning and my heart pounding, refusing to look in Pamela's direction. Then the bell rang and I went home. Middle school life went on. Emily, Christy, and I would become lifelong friends. For Pamela, life continued to not be very kind. If she had friends, I can't remember any. My family moved away when I was 15. I heard from my friends she had gotten pregnant our senior year of high school, and soon after that disappeared from school altogether. I would go on to college and grad school, eventually becoming a psychologist, working with children and their families. All the things that now drew out my empathy, poverty, lack of parental guidance, peer rejection, were the exact things that had drawn my disdain all those years ago. The kids I worked with, the ones I would take into my care, outcasts often for reasons beyond their control, were the ones I would grow to care about most of all. But as any therapist will tell you, how you act in the therapy hour is not always how you conduct your life. Two summers ago, I found myself at my 20-year high school reunion with all those same middle school feelings of insecurity and wanting to be accepted, bubbling quietly beneath the surface. One of those popular girls stood near the name tags and made nervous small talk with me. She gave me an anxious smile, saying, "Well, I guess we have to go in eventually." Yes, we did. And there she was. It took me a moment to figure out how this face was familiar and strange at the same time. And then, of course, Pamela. Having walked in by myself, I searched for my friends, but it was too late. Pamela was by my side. "Hi, Erica," she said with a smile, no hint of anger in her voice. "Hi, Pamela. Good to see you. How have you been?" While my mouth said these words, the dialogue in my head was more like, "Do you remember the note? Do you remember the note? Do you remember the note? Why are you being so nice to me?" She chatted away while I felt trapped, nervously choking down my glass of Chardonnay and looking for an exit. At some point, I thought she'd walk away to talk with others. In fact, I wish she would. And then I realized there wasn't anyone else who wanted to talk to her, and she had come alone. Over 20 years later, and the social tears were still present. Talking to her after so much time, I realized something that my sixth grade self seemed to grasp intuitively. It didn't matter how nice I wanted to be. It didn't matter if I felt empathy for whatever crappy life circumstances had come Pamela's way. The cold, hard truth was that I just didn't want to be her friend. A few days after the reunion, I logged into Facebook to see a few new friend requests. I clicked on the last one. Pamela Groot requests to be your friend. Accept friend request? I clicked yes. Thank you.